Good guys. So it's actually Saturday, so good morning. It's actually like, it's 12:33 a.m. my time. And I wanted to know the answer to this simple question. If you don't believe we can make a difference in the Kenneka Jenkins case, why are you here? Is it for entertainment? Is it just curiosity? Is it boredom? Gossip? Why are you here? And if that's your take on it, that we can't make a difference, I would have to believe that you would be a very negative person or maybe just a pessimist. Because I wouldn't be taking the time to do the things that I'm doing, just me by myself, if I didn't feel like me alone could make a difference. Much less me and a team of people. That's the kind of faith I have in myself. Because I believe all things are possible. Like I've said before, I don't like the word no. I haven't been told no very often. And I'm not going to settle for a no. I'm just not. And I know that. I know that about myself. So let's start very simple. We're going to take it very, very basic. It is very possible to, at the very least, get this investigation reopened. It is very possible. Don't think that it's not. Don't listen to someone who says that it's not. Because they're a naysayer. Because you have to look at what this is. This is a closed police investigation. This is not a closed court case. And I think that people sometimes get confused on that. No one was ever charged in this case. This was chalked off as an accident. Have you all not been watching the news lately? Does the name Robert Fuller ring a bell with you? What did they do in that case? I'll wait. I'll sit here and wait. I don't hear anybody. Let me refresh your memory. I shouldn't have to because this is just a couple of weeks old. They found Robert Fuller hanging from a tree in California, close to City Hall. They ruled his death a suicide. The public went nuts, bananas. And guess what? Someone overrode the police and are now looking into the case as a hate crime. So don't tell me that something can't get done. Don't sit here and tell me that shit. It angers me that people don't have the faith in themselves that they should. And I'm just one person. One person. And I feel like I can make a difference. If only everyone felt like that, we really have something here. So let's just take a look at a few things. You can't look at the court case without getting a police investigation opened. Because without the police investigation being reopened, there is no court case. If we could just get a fair shake, if Kenneka could just get a fair shake, at somebody looking at this and seeing the things that thousands of other people see, wouldn't you feel better? Seriously. I would feel like somebody gave a damn about this case. So you have to start small. People are already looking at, oh, she'll never win the case. Well, damn, we ain't even got a case yet. You done counted it out before it even got going. You can't start like that. That's that very pessimist bullshit. And I don't deal with pessimists. And really, it's disrespectful. Especially when you come on my channel with that bullshit. I don't like it. Everybody's entitled to their opinion. But there are times when you keep that shit to yourself. Take that shit somewhere else. Sorry for the cussing, but it really angers me. And I've had just about enough. So if you want to be disrespectful, take that shit somewhere else, man. For real. Go comment on somebody else's channel with that bullshit. Because I'm not with it over here. I'm all about positivity and trying to get something done. And if you're negative from jump, why are you here? I just don't understand that. I don't understand that. You can't make me understand it. This is not entertainment. This is a deceased girl who, in my opinion and several thousands of other people's opinion, was murdered. Plain and simple. So I don't understand why people are investing their time in this case, coming to the lives, commenting, making videos. I mean, what are you doing? Are you just doing it to show off your skill? That you can make a video? That you know how to break down footage? That you can do a presentation or do research? Man, who gives a damn about that? I could show off too. But it, to me, it's about trying to get something done. And I want to get something done in this case. And this is my best damn attempt to try to motivate people to do that. To get on board, cut out all the BS, all the crazy theories. And it cracks me up because people actually subscribe to these channels and listen to this mess. Listen to it. And there's no proof. If a person can't produce proof, why are you listening to them? And let's look at a few things. Here's a case from September the 16th, 2019. A snapshot leads police to reopen investigation of CSU student's death and raises questions about gun violence. The family of Finnegan Daly didn't believe Fort Collins police and pressed the Larimer County District Attorney to take a new look at a case mirrored in questions. In his senior year at Colorado State University as part of an internship application, Finnegan Daly sat down to list his goals for the future. He wanted to travel abroad, land a job as a financial advisor, and buy a house. 3 to 5 years down the road, he hoped to run a marathon, become a certified financial planner, and start a family. Quote, he was serious and driven with a gifted mind, said Regina Daly, his mother. 2 days before the 2018 spring semester started, he died from a gunshot wound in an off-campus house. Fort Collins police ruled Daly's death accidental and closed the case 2 months later without it ever drawing public attention. But his family didn't believe investigators. They discovered a key piece of evidence police overlooked, a photo posted to Snapchat, taken before the 21-year-old died, that put the gun that killed him in a roommate's hand. The revelation cast the entire case in doubt, exposing what the family says was an investigation marked by discrepancies and oversights. But now, after a rare move to reopen the case, prosecutors are pursuing three criminal charges against Coleman Carver, the roommate who owned the gun. Carver, now 22, is not suspected of shooting his roommate, but is accused of weapons charges and tampering with evidence, all three of which could lead to time behind bars. He is scheduled to appear in court Tuesday. Much of the case, and even what led investigators to make the arrest, remains shrouded in mystery, with records suppressed or missing. In the void, the situation raises questions for the family about the strength of Colorado's gun laws and whether they should have prevented the tragedy. Carver had four guns at the time of the shooting: a military-style AR-15 carbine, a Remington pump action shotgun, a Springfield 45 caliber handgun, and a Glock 34 9mm semi-automatic handgun with a mounted flashlight and 17-round magazine. The bullet that killed Daly came from the Glock 34. In addition to her questions about the investigation, Regina Daly said the case is, quote, about the 100 people that die every day and enforcing the gun law, she said. If there were no guns in the house, she said, her son would be alive. And there's a picture of him. Here's another case. This article is from January 23rd, 2020. It's titled, State Representative Wants 2014 Lansing Drowning Investigation Reopened. Shirley Michener has a lot of unanswered questions about her son's 2014 death. She mainly wants to know, was the 22-year-old's death really an accident or was someone at fault? Brandon Michener fell into the Grand River June 24, 2014, after a night of drinking as he celebrated a friend's 21st birthday. Surveillance footage from a nearby house showed him and another man walking by the river near South Street shortly before he disappeared. His body was pulled from the river the next day near the Elm Street Bridge. The Lansing Police Department determined Brandon's death was accidental and have stood by that conclusion. Quote, I have been diagnosed with being depressed, Shirley Michener said. My depression is coming because I have no answers on what happened to my child. That's a picture of Shirley Michener holding a picture of her son, Brandon. State Representative Cynthia Johnson, Democrat out of Detroit, emailed Lansing Mayor Andy Schroer Tuesday asking him to reopen Brandon's death investigation. Johnson met with Michener after the mother reached out to her. Quote, it may be 5 years later, but Brandon is still somebody's child, Johnson said. It just needs to be reopened and done right. If you are a black male or black woman, your issues are not as important. We just need to stop that, end quote. Reopening the investigation. Johnson said too many unanswered questions exist for the case to be fully resolved. Like Michener, she believes Brandon's death may not have been accidental. Quote, I'm not going to ignore the issue, Johnson said. This case needs to be reopened. And that's a picture of her son. In December, Lansing police passed Brandon's case to Michigan State Police to get another set of eyes on it. Lansing Police Chief Daryl Green said, if Michigan State Police determines there is probable cause to reopen the case, they will do so, he said. A Michigan State Police investigator is in the process of reviewing the case. MSP Lieutenant Brian Oleksyk said. Sorry, I butchered that name. This is not the first time police have been asked to reopen Brandon's case. 4 years after Brandon's death, one of his friends reached out to Michener and told her a mutual friend knew what had happened to Brandon. The man said the mutual friend, quote, made a statement that indicated the man who was with Brandon the night he died admitted responsibility of Michener's death to him, according to the police report. New information in the case? After 9 unsuccessful attempts to contact the mutual friend over the course of 2 months in 2018, a Lansing Police Department detective gave up trying to reach the friend. After prompting for Michener in 2019, another investigator reached out to the man, but also did not receive a response. Police were never able to confirm if the information was true. The man who was with Brandon the night he died told police he thought Brandon fell down near the sidewalk, possibly over the edge of the embankment, because he heard a thud. He thought he was puking, so he ran to call a friend. He couldn't find Brandon after that, he told police. He has little memory of the night, as both he and Brandon were intoxicated, police said. There's so many things we don't know the answer to, Michener said. At the end of the day, I want to know what happened to my child. Here's another one. 20-year-old cold case of Chattanooga boys killing reopened with help of FBI. This is dated February 26, 2020. There's the kid, Joshua Walden. The Hamilton County District Attorney's Office Cold Case Unit is reopening a nearly 20-year-old case, and this time, they're bringing in the FBI. December the 9th, 2000 was a Saturday. Crystal Walden, who was 17 at the time, called police to report her 10-year-old brother, Joshua Lee Walden, as missing from their 14th Avenue home. Joshua was last seen day before riding his red bicycle near his home, according to Times Free Press archives. Friends, neighbors, and police searched the neighborhood but found no sign of him. His body was found that Sunday in a wooded area near the 3100 block of 16th Avenue, about a half mile from his home. His body was doused with muriatic acid. An autopsy showed the boy died from asphyxiation, and his bicycle was never recovered. In about 2004, investigators asked for the public's help in finding the boy's killer. At the time, the FBI offered a possible profile and even suggested that law enforcement probably already had contact with the offender over the course of the investigation. But years later, Joshua's killer has still not been found. Now the DA's cold case unit is again asking the public for help and will be working with a team of FBI agents who produced a series of videos they hope will help us solve this case. Quote, "That's all I need is just closure," Crystal Walden says in one, a video released Wednesday. "If it was an accident, I mean, it was an accident. They didn't mean to do it. They didn't mean to hurt him. They panicked, and you know, people panic in different ways and handle things in different ways. I just need to know." Anyone who has information about this case is urged to call the DA's cold case unit at 423-209-7470 or to send an email to coldcases@hcdatn.org. And this right here is what I'm talking about right here. More than 1 million signed petition to reopen investigation of Aurora police involvement in Elijah McClain's death. This is dated June the 8th, 2020. That's a picture of Elijah McClain. An unarmed 23-year-old black man was walking home from when Aurora police put him in a chokehold and forced him on the ground for 15 minutes. Paramedics then injected him with a sedative, ketamine. McClain apparently suffered a heart attack, fell into a coma, and died once taken off life support August the 30th, 6 days after his encounter with officers. More than 1 million people have signed an online petition calling for Aurora officials to reopen the investigation into the death of Elijah McClain, a 23-year-old unarmed black man, who died in August following an encounter with Aurora police and paramedics. The petition calls on Adams County District Attorney Dave Young, along with Mayor Mike Coffin and the Aurora Police Department, to, quote, bring justice for Elijah by conducting, quote, a more in-depth, end quote, investigation and removing the officers involved from duty. Quote, "We are aware of the petition," Michael Bryant, spokesperson for the city of Aurora, told Colorado Politics in a phone interview June the 8th. Quote, "But there has not been a public response to that petition yet." The Aurora Police Department also is aware of the petition, Department spokesman Officer Matthew Longshore said the same day. Quote, "We're always reviewing our policies and procedures to see if there's any changes that need to be made," he said. "We're taking this petition into consideration, but we haven't made any determinations at this point." A day later, Aurora's interim police chief, Vanessa Williams, held a press conference to announce the department would ban carotid pressure holds, often referred to as choke holds, and implement four other policy changes, all effective immediately. Both Bryant and Longshore have said that the decision to reopen the investigation would have to come from Young's office. "I don't open up investigations based on petitions," Young told Colorado Politics in a phone interview late Monday afternoon. "Obviously, if there is new evidence to look at, I will look at the evidence in any case. But no," he said, "I'm not going to open up an investigation because people are signing a petition." Three Aurora City Council members have since called on the city manager to launch an independent investigation into McLean's death. In November, Young, the 17th Judicial District Attorney, ruled that criminal charges would not be pressed against officers involved in the detention and arrest of McLean because there were no indisputable evidence that an officer used, quote, unjustified, end quote, force. In February, the Aurora Police Department said force applied during the encounter was consistent with training as determined by a force review board. McLean encountered police on August the 24th while on his way home from buying four cans of brisk tea at a gas station in Aurora. Officers put McLean, a Denver native and massage therapist in Aurora, in a chokehold and forced him on the ground for 15 minutes. McLean eventually began vomiting and complained he couldn't breathe. Quote, "There was a physical struggle," former APD chief Nick Metz said in October. "When police saw McLean, they told him to stop. He wouldn't stop. Again, he was wearing a ski mask. It's 10:30 p.m. at night in a residential area, so obviously that creates some concern." At the time, Metz said that because McLean appeared to be in a, quote, agitated mental state, police requested backup from Aurora fire paramedics, who injected McLean with the sedative ketamine to subdue his reported anxiety before driving him to a hospital. McLean apparently suffered a heart attack, fell into a coma, and died once taken off of life support August the 30th. The recent death of George Floyd, a 46-year-old black man who died in custody of white Minneapolis police officers, has sparked outrage against police brutality across the country and across the world, including in Aurora. His death appears to have also strengthened ongoing calls for justice around McLean's death, as his name can be heard at the ongoing protests happening in Denver and beyond. As of early Friday morning, the online petition had garnered more than 1.1 million signatures since it was started by Piper Rundell a week ago. The goal of the petition was created on change.org is to reach 1.5 million signatures after surpassing its original goal of 1 million. Aurora City Manager Jim Twomley in February announced that he would be initiating a critical incident review to further examine how Aurora police and fire departments responded in the McLean case. Quote, "This is for an outside independent review of the details of the case and the policies and procedures that were in place, and whether there were any recommended charges, or changes, rather, that need to come from it," Bryant said. On Thursday, Aurora nixed its contract with the investigator after it came to light that the Connecticut-based attorney was a former police officer. His replacement will be picked by the mayor and the city council. Twomley also said in February that he was launching an audit of APD's body-worn cameras to, quote, "take a critical look at our policies, how well APD complies with policies, laws, and best practices related to the use of body-worn cameras, as well as the equipment itself." In February, Aurora City Council also commissioned a police task force to study police controversies and, if needed, make recommendations around policy changes and establishing civilian oversight, Bryant told Colorado Politics. The creator of that committee was delayed by the coronavirus epidemic, Bryant said, but Kaufman requested Aurora City Council hold a special council meeting at 6 p.m. on June the 15th, in which members are expected to be named. The task force comes in the wake of multiple high-profile cases involving Aurora police. The American Civil Liberties Union and others have filed several lawsuits over the years against the city of Aurora over officer-involved shootings, and the city has paid out millions of dollars as a result. "There is a pattern here that is disturbing," Denise Mays, public policy director of ACLU Colorado, said in November during a heated town hall discussion about Aurora policing. The organization, alongside others, has long advocated for an independent authority to monitor police shootings. And May says she was, quote, not sure why the city of Aurora has resisted. And another one. Information on possible gang motive prompts Pasadena police to reopen investigation into 2013 killing. This is from September the 16th, 2019. Police in Pasadena have reopened their investigation into the 2013 shooting death of a 35-year-old Monrovian man after receiving new information that the victim was targeted by members of a local street gang. Tyrone English was gunned down about 8:40 p.m. on February the 28th, 2013 in the 600 block of North Mar Vista Avenue, according to Pasadena Police Department Lieutenant Jesse Carrillo. Officers responded to a shooting call and found English unresponsive, suffering from multiple gunshot wounds. He was pronounced dead at the scene, Carrillo said. Detectives were unable to identify whoever was responsible for the killing. Quote, recent information has come to light, providing Pasadena detectives an opportunity to further the investigation, end quote, he said Monday. Quote, new information suggests that victim Tyrone English was intentionally targeted by members of the Pasadena Denver Lane Bloods criminal street gang, resulting in his murder, end quote. Investigators are following up on the new information in an effort to identify the person or people responsible for English's death. Carrillo said. Anyone with information about the case was urged to call Pasadena police. And another one. State reopens probe into suicide at Celebrity Rehab Hospital following current investigation. This is from November the 25th, 2019. It says the Silver Hill Hospital in New Canaan, Connecticut, where the State Department of Public Health has reopened its probe into the 2018 suicide of Wall Street investment banker Leo J. Civitiello. The State Department of Public Health has reopened its probe into the 2008 suicide of a Wall Street investment banker who overdosed on malaria pills at Silver Hill Hospital in New Canaan after a current investigation identified unanswered questions related to the hospital's initial report of the death and the health department's delay in responding. Department spokesman A.V. Harris confirmed Monday that investigators are taking the unusual step of reopening a probe they closed 9 months ago and will be returning to the exclusive psychiatric hospital to review the death of Leo Civitiello, 43, who killed himself in February 2018, just days after researching ways to commit suicide and on one of the hospital's communal iPads. Civitiello's estate recently filed a wrongful death lawsuit against Silver Hill Hospital, alleging that the hospital ignored his suicidal ideation, failed to properly do bed checks, and falsified hospital records. A current review found additional issues and pressed the department for answers late last week. It took the state more than a year to investigate Civitiello's suicide, despite receiving a phone call from Silver Hill shortly after the death that indicated the state medical examiner was conducting an autopsy. When they did finally look into the death as part of a routine state visit at the facility, department inspectors failed to delve into the dangerous circumstances surrounding the suicide, how a deadly dose of malaria pills ended up in a psychiatric facility, and why a visitor not on the official list was able to have unsupervised contact with Civitiello. And while the DPH's inspection report also points to potential lapses in care, including questions about how often bed checks were performed, the only action imposed on Silver Hill was a requirement for a written plan of correction. The current investigation was based on police reports, hospital records, and state and federal inspection narratives that raised numerous questions about the state's response to a death at a hospital that, by its nature, deals with suicidal patients who may be intent on killing themselves. Following the inquiries from the current about the case, DPH managers and inspectors reviewed the Silver Hill file and decided there was enough questions to warrant a reopening of the case, Harris said Monday. Harris said reopening the investigation will involve site visits and a review of all the hospital's records related the patient's death and suicide prevention protocols. When asked to comment, Silverheel officials declined to acknowledge that Civitello was ever a patient at Silverheel. Quote, given our commitment to the privacy of our patients, we are not in a position to respond to any specific story or confirm that any individual was or was not our patient, said Andrew J. Gerber, the hospital's president and medical director. Other issues raised by the current in the wake of Civitello's death include: it is unclear whether DPH ever learned that Civitello had died of a drug overdose, whether anyone at DPH had reviewed the state medical examiner's report, or whether health inspectors knew that the patient had advanced rigor mortis by the time medics began trying CPR on him. In a report by phone days after Civitello killed himself, someone at Silverheel notified the Department of Public Health about his death, but said only that, quote, a patient expired, and that the medical examiner had taken the case. The reference to the medical examiner was critical in that the office only investigates questionable deaths. Did you hear that? The reference to the medical examiner was critical in that the office only investigates questionable deaths. The hospital failed to mention it was a suicide by drug overdose or that he had ingested a massive dose of malaria pills, and DPH officials failed to ask about the nature of the death. When Wilton police, who had been called after the suicide, asked hospital officials to review a communal iPad used by Civitello to research suicide by pills and obituaries, the officials refused and instead alerted the hospital's attorney, who ordered the officer not to leave the hospital grounds with any of Civitello's belongings and to ask no questions. The state's medical examiners ruled that Civitello had more than 45 times the normal amount of chloroquine, I know I'm not pronouncing that right, the active ingredient in malaria pills, in his system. The police report also surmised that Civitello had been dead for up to 10 to 12 hours before he was found, raising questions about the hospital's statement that bed checks had been done every 2 hours throughout the night and only one may have been missed. That discrepancy is highlighted in the lawsuit against Silverheel. Once receiving the initial phone call from Silverheel, DPH investigators could have ruled there was an immediate danger and gone into the hospital to inspect it within 2 days, or they could have determined there was danger, but of a less urgent nature, and gone in within 10 days, but they did neither, choosing instead to wait until the next on-site visit a year later. DPH also could have reviewed the medical examiner's finding in April 2018 on Civitello's death and responded then. The report eventually completed by DPH based on the February 27, 2019 site visit is less detailed than others the department has done on deaths and dangerous circumstances at a wide range of state facilities and private general hospitals. It does note that Silverheel staff members were troubled that Civitello, identified as, quote, patient 2, had, quote, used the hospital's shared computer tablet to look at, quote, concerning websites related to, quote, suicide methods, autopsies, and to research an obituary in patient number 2's name. But at a meeting of hospital staff, it was agreed patient number 2, who repeatedly denied suicidal and homicidal ideation, could stay in the transitional program safely. DPH inspectors noted that, quote, the record failed to reflect that a re-evaluation of patient number 2 was completed. The state report also speaks to the night Civitello died, February 17, 2018. DPH reviewed the bed check log and it indicated that the patient, quote, was observed sleeping through the night, end quote. But in the morning at approximately 8:30, according to the DPH report, patient number 2, quote, was unresponsive, pulseless, cyanotic, and extremities were cold, end quote. DPH ultimately cited Silverheel for failing to ensure that patients were cared for in a safe setting. The inspector said that the hospital failed to conduct patient suicide risk assessments, failed to monitor the patients, failed to, quote, to implement appropriate interventions after the patient's verbalized suicidal ideations, end quote. The hospital's corrective plan was accepted by DPH a short time later. No fines were issued because psychiatric hospitals are exempt from monetary penalties. Police investigation stymied. When Wilton police officer Joseph Colarossi arrived at Silver Hill Hospital on February 17, 2018, he was brought to a ground floor room where he saw two EMTs from New Canaan performing CPR on Civitilio. Within a minute or two, someone mentioned that rigor mortis had already set in, and efforts to revive the man were stopped. I can't even believe I just read that. Although the address of Silver Hill is in New Canaan, part of the campus is in neighboring Wilton. After Colarossi, overheard a staff member say that, quote, Leo had recently searched suicide by pills, end quote, on an iPad, he ordered the room sealed and called Sergeant Anthony Coco, who upon his arrival ordered detectives to respond to the hospital. Coco would later report that when he arrived, a staff member told him she felt Civitilio shouldn't have been in the building where the transitional living program is housed because, quote, he wasn't ready for it. Back to that doing CPR and rigor mortis. Sound familiar? And I'm wondering if that's why we don't have an ambulance report. Because that was rigor mortis. It was not freezing. Think about that. Chew on that. A patient in transitional living has less supervision than in other units. In Civitilio's case, hospital records indicate Silver Hill did not increase its observation even after hospital officials had discovered the troubling websites that he had searched on the community iPad. As detectives went through the room and waited for a representative from the medical examiner's office to arrive, Colarossi collected Civitilio's wedding ring, watch, a card, a stuffed animal his wife and three daughters had given him, hairspray, a bottle of cologne, and a deck of cards. He then went to the front desk to start interviewing Silver Hill staff. Civitilio had a cell phone, but hospital officials refused to turn it over to police without a search warrant. He asked about the communal iPad that Civitilio had used to research suicide methods and was told staff wouldn't turn that over either, according to the Wilton police report. As he prepared to leave the facility and bring the items back to the police station, a doctor handed him a cell phone and said the hospital's legal counsel was on the phone. The attorney advised Colarossi that he couldn't remove anything from the hospital grounds without a search warrant. Colarossi said that he had only removed Civitilio's personal property for safekeeping and that it would be better for his family to get the items from a police officer rather than a random Silver Hill staff member. The attorney once again told him he couldn't remove the items and said she was coming to the facility in person. Colarossi ignored the request and left taking the items with him, which he turned over to family members the next day, the police report said. When family members asked about the decision to contact the medical examiner, Colarossi said that police hadn't uncovered anything suspicious about the death, but that perhaps the autopsy and toxicology reports would give the family some answers as to what happened. Under state statute, the medical examiner does autopsies in cases of violent deaths, whether apparently homicidal, suicidal, or accidental, sudden or unexpected deaths not caused by readily recognizable disease, deaths under suspicious circumstances, deaths of persons whose bodies are to be cremated, deaths related to disease resulting from employment or to accident while employed, or deaths related to disease which might constitute a threat to public health. In April 2018, the medical examiner released its final report ruling Civitilio's death a suicide by drug overdose. Because the death was not considered a homicide, Wilton police closed their investigation. Allegations of doctored records. Silver Hill Hospital is known as a place that celebrities such as Billy Joel, Mariah Carey, John Hamm, and Rita Hayworth went for alcohol and drug rehabilitation stints. It also is one of the only private mental health facilities in the state that caters to mostly upscale clients, charging as much as $10,000 to $15,000 a day. Civitella was admitted to Silver Hill on January 22, 2018, following a previous suicide attempt. He was diagnosed as depressed and placed on olanzapine, an antipsychotic drug. However, the lawsuit alleges doctors later reduced his doses without explanation. On February 15th, Civitella asked a counselor if he could use the hospital's iPad that is shared among patients. When he returned the computer, a staff nurse became concerned at some of the websites he had visited, including one on ways to commit suicide and how an autopsy is conducted. The staff also discovered he had researched obituaries under his own name, the lawsuit said. Doctors confronted Civitella, who denied he was considering suicide. He was supposed to be re-evaluated the next day by his physician, but wasn't, according to the hospital records attached to the lawsuit. The staff also never increased the bed check times for him at night, keeping the checks at two-hour intervals rather than increasing them to every hour or even every half hour in dire cases, or move him to a more secure unit. Hospital records allege that bed checks on February the 17th were done at 1 a.m., 3 a.m., 5 a.m., and 7 a.m. The staff notes indicated that he had been checked each time and was sleeping and had no issues. Those records are in conflict with the conclusion by the medical examiner's death investigator that Civitella was dead for up to 10 hours or more before he was found by hospital staff. It was later determined when State Department of Public Health officials investigated the death more than a year later that the 7 a.m. check hadn't been done. Hospital officials later told DPH investigators that the staff member who was supposed to have done those checks and didn't, he was fired immediately, but the lawsuit alleges that the bed check records were deliberately falsified. Inspection reopened. In an interview, DPH's Barbara Cass, chief of the Healthcare Quality and Safety Branch, discussed the hospital's initial report to DPH. Quote, "It didn't appear there was any foul play," end quote, said Cass, but after considering that the medical examiner only performs autopsies on questionable deaths, Cass added, quote, "We don't always get all the details we need," end quote. She said DPH's decision to wait until the hospital was due for a license inspection 1 year later was, quote, "based on information we had," end quote. That information did not include the nature of the patient's death. Quote, "Typically a suicide would raise response to a very high priority," Cass said. She acknowledged that had DPH responded within days of the death, quote, "we might have looked at it differently and it could have altered our enforcement action," end quote. She said the passage of a year between the death and the inspection, quote, "did affect whether we were able to find immediate jeopardy," end quote. Cass also said that it was potentially significant that the hospital did not transfer the patient, quote, "to an acute floor with the highest level of observation," end quote, after the concerns were raised about the patient's online research of suicide methods and researching obituaries under his own name. We're going to get real basic with this now. I mean, I could go on and on and on with cases. On and on and on of cases that where the family didn't request that the case be opened. Anyone can request that a case be opened if you can get the right person to look at it. That's just facts. This is from WikiHow. WikiHow. How to convince police to reopen a case. It was co-authored by Clinton M. Sandvik, who has a Juris Doctorate and a PhD, Doctor of Law, University of Wisconsin-Madison, and it's dated March 29, 2019. Getting police to reopen a closed or, quote, cold case can be hard work. After all, the main objective of police officers is to pursue and solve current crimes. There is a far greater chance of solving crimes shortly after they occur, as opposed to months or even years after the fact. It may even seem that as far as the police are concerned, the matter is over. However, officers remain assigned to these old cases, and many do periodically review these cases as time permits. If you have a good reason to ask for an old case to be reopened, it's worth trying. They then go with steps. Part 1 of 3. Finding new evidence. Gather basic information about the crime. In order to fully educate yourself about the crime, you first will need to identify basic facts that will allow you to look further into the matter. People with whom you want to discuss the case are more likely to remember it if you can accurately describe the facts of the case. For instance, you should know the full name of the victim or victims, other identifying information about the victim, such as date of birth, approximate age, social security number, and physical description, the location of the crime, the date on which the crime occurred, how the crime was carried out, contact information for all law enforcement agencies that worked on the case in the past, name and contact information for any police officers or detectives who worked on the case in the past, case numbers that originally were assigned to the case, the date of the last contact that you had with any law enforcement agency about the case, and the person with whom you spoke. Number 2. Go back through all the case notes and evidence to which you have access. Look for things that might have been missed or appear to have been tampered with or doctored. If you want a case reopened because you believe that the police were corrupt or forced a confession, you'll need evidence of this. Also, talk to as many relevant witnesses as you're able to contact and who are willing to testify. Number 3. Talk to the victim in the case. Get good information from that person about why he or she believes that the case should be reopened. Speaking with the victim may enable you to obtain more information and evidence to support the victim's wishes. That's when you have a victim that's still living. 4. Consider those who have committed more recent crimes. It is no surprise that people who commit crimes and don't get caught will continue to commit crimes. Additionally, people who never get caught often will eventually brag to other criminals about their crimes, especially when incarcerated. It may be worth taking a look at currently incarcerated individuals or suspects of other crimes to see if these more current crimes resemble your old case in any way. Number 5. Assemble your new evidence. One of the easiest ways to get a case reopened is to discover new evidence that wasn't available at the time the case was investigated or closed. It will be much harder to convince police that a case is worth reopening if you don't have this. DNA is an often used element of new evidence these days that gets some cases reopened because genetic testing abilities are much more advanced than they used to be. National fingerprint databases also exist now that did not exist in the past. They may serve as a comparison point for fingerprints taken in an old case. Part 2 of 3. Speaking with the police. Number 1. Make an appointment with the police officer assigned to the case. Preferably, try to arrange to speak with a senior or veteran police officer regarding the matter. Be careful that your inquiry doesn't fall between the cracks just because you're talking to a rookie who is too wet behind the ears to understand what is needed. Number 2. Be polite. It is not likely to help persuade police to reopen an old case if you are rude, demanding, or insulting about the work that was previously done on the case. While there is nothing wrong with being persuasive, and even a bit insistent, putting down the officer who handled the case is unlikely to win you any friends. Number 3. Be organized. Have your argument ready and completely outlined before your appointment. If you can present a rational and well-organized argument, you will have a better chance of getting the case reopened. Number 4. Explain your relationship to the case. Your argument to reopen the case may be more compelling if you have a personal interest in the case. If you are the victim or a close relative to the victim, it will be easier to explain to police why you want the old case reopened. This also might be the case if you are a former roommate, friend, or co-worker of the victim. This relationship will give you more credibility in arguing to reopen the case. Doesn't have to have that. It's just a suggestion. 5. Ask how the agency handles cold cases. Do they regularly publicize cold cases and request tips from the public? Do they have a blog or Facebook page that keeps the public aware about unsolved cases? Some cities and towns have made efforts to raise awareness about cold cases by regularly posting facts about them online and reminding the public that certain cases remain unsolved. This is not a cold case. Number 6, leave your contact information with police. It is likely that the officer to whom you speak will ask you to leave detailed contact information with him or her after your appointment. Be prepared to give contact information at the end of your appointment where you can easily be reached. 7, keep a written record of your appointment. You should take notes during your appointment with the police officer so that you have an accurate record of what you discussed. This will be helpful to you in the future if you want to make further contact with that law enforcement agency. Part 3 of 3, getting help. Get a good lawyer or advocate. If you don't feel that you can address an old case or ask to get it reopened alone, get some legal advice. Talk to someone who has a good understanding of the laws and policies surrounding the reopening of police cases to guide you. You might be able to get legal assistance in some circumstances, depending on where you reside and the reasons that you wish to reopen the case. Number 2, hire a private investigator. If you feel that more evidence exists or that an investigation of a crime was not done properly, you might have success in getting a private investigator to look more closely into the matter. Some private investigators may be willing to put more time and effort into an investigation, even regarding an older case, simply because they have the resources to do so. All too often, police officers are stretched thin and other crimes may take priority over the case in which you are interested. Number 3, speak with the police officers who worked on the original case. Especially if a significant amount of time has passed since the crime occurred, officers or detectives may have retired. Contact those officers if possible and try to get their views on the case. Number 4, contact the media. Getting a newspaper or television reporter interested in the case is a good way to exert some pressure on local authorities. A well-written story in the newspaper or local television can renew public interest in a case and cause the authorities to take a second look at an old case or evidence that may pertain to it. Number 5, talk to your local senator, representative, or governor's office. Bringing political pressure to bear can have an important impact on the police decision to reopen a case. Taking this step may also result in you getting the attention of a police officer or detective who has more influence on the decision to reopen old cases. And that is so true. All of that is so true. Every single bit of it. So, there are a lot of things that can be done in this case that have not been tried and have not been done. Trust me. Trust me. We all have different state representatives. We all have different senators. We all have different everything that we can all reach out to. There are so many news organizations. There are so many things that can be done in this case. So don't tell me that it takes the family to reopen a case, because that's simply not true. And please don't sit here and tell me that there's nothing that can be done in this case. Please don't do that. Please don't. I'm trying to get wound down so I can go actually to bed. But this just really had me fired up tonight, because it's just so negative and it's really disappointing that that is actually a thought. And then that brought me to the next question. Why are you even here if that's your thinking behind it? That nothing's going to get done? You can't go into something like that. You're never going to get anywhere if that's your attitude. That's all I have for right now. I hope that people actually listen to this and can actually see that there's a lot of things that can be done in this case. So please don't listen to the naysayers that say there can't be anything done in this case. I appreciate your time. I really do. And I appreciate you taking the time out of your day to comment or do whatever you need to do. But I will tell you that it does aggravate me just because I don't do it. If I watch a video and I don't agree with someone, especially as me being a content creator, I don't go to someone else's channel and leave some BS comment that's just basically nitpicking. I don't like it. I think it's disrespectful. Even if you don't agree with me, just keep it moving. I don't like it. And I don't do it to other people. I may comment on other channels, but it's not in a negative fashion. So I just personally don't like it. It offends me. I don't like it. I just think it can be avoided altogether. You don't have to go that route with it. if you're a mature and adult. So, I hope everybody really listens to this video and really understands that we can do something. We can do something together if we all stay focused on what's important. Thanks, guys.